Hello and welcome to the 2018 training program of the I2B2 Transmart Foundation. Today is our last class for 2018. Today we have Alina Fedorovich from Rancho Bioscience, who will be giving a webinar on using Transmart on complex clinical data sets. This is part of our larger training program that runs every month. We have a new topic either on I2B2 or Transmart, and these sessions are all recorded and made available for you either on the I2B2 Transmart website and also on the Foundation's YouTube channel. We will make this recording available within a few days, and you'll be able to review it and tell your colleagues. We'll be announcing shortly the 2019 training program and the topics that we'll be covering then. So now let's welcome Alina, and she will give us our the training.
Okay, thank you, Rudy, for the introduction. Welcome, everyone. I'm going to share my screen now.
Yes, you should have the
do you see my screen?
There you go. Yes, looks fine.
Good. So at this session, we'll go through some main features of Transmart using two big clinical data sets. Our agenda today is after a brief background information on Transmart, Michael J. Fox Foundation and PPMI and BioFind clinical data sets overview and access. We'll proceed to demonstration in Transmart. And we'll do some analysis of clinical data from these two studies using some major functionalities of Transmart 16.2. I think it's always useful to remind users who know Transmart that Transmart is a data warehouse for translational medicine and clinical research. It is a platform that allows to store data, integrate and analyze together various data types, such as omics data and phenotypic data, share data and results of data analysis between collaborating groups. After version 1 release in 2012, Transmart platform advanced to several upgraded versions, and today we'll use version 16.2, which has Smart R connection, subsetting on omics data, Ingenuity IPA pathway analysis connector, genome browser and MetaCore plugins, XNet imaging platform interface, GWASP link integration and results enhancement, as well as ETL improvements compared to previous versions of Transmart. Additional information about the platform and also on training materials, webinars, and more can be found on Transmart Foundation webpage. Wikia Transmart Foundation contains user guides, and I recommend everybody who starting to use Transmart or analysis or want to use it again. Just as a reminder, use Transmart version 1.2 user guide as well as Transmart version 16.2. Documentation is there available. Michael J. Fox Foundation supports Parkinson's disease research. Its initiative has a data curation program with a purpose to make the field of Parkinson's disease research more efficient and expedient to help avoiding duplication of efforts in the pre-competitive space of curated data sets, to provide researchers with harmonized high-quality analysis, ready data sets, and access to data analytics free of charge. In 2017, access to Parkinson's disease data in Transmart was created for quick analysis via NeuroShare data access portal. It allows to download Parkinson's datasets in CSV and text format. Datasets available there are PPMI and BioFind. However, as a continued evolution to fuel the use of big data in brain disease research, Fox Foundation announced recently their partnership with Cohen Veterans Bioscience on new platform, Brain Commons platform. And this happened in October 2018. PPMI and BioFind will be available in NeuroShare portal during transition period to Brain Commons. So, because there is still access available to NeuroShare, You can find raw data and curated data on PPMind BioFind in Transmart on Nearshare data portal. Here's the link. And you can also access Transmart using this link. You have to register to be able to use it. For access, you register to MGFF Data Access Center only once. You have to also get access in Loni and request access to datasets to be able to load raw data from Nearshare. Now, this is a brief overview of PPMI and BioFind. PPMI is the Parkinson's Progression Markers Initiative. It's a landmark observational clinical study to comprehensively evaluate cohorts of significant interest using advanced imaging, biologic sampling, and clinical and behavioral assessments to identify biomarkers of Parkinson's disease progression. It is a longitudinal ongoing study taking place in the United States, Europe, Israel, and Australia. BioFind is an observational clinical study designed to discover and verify biomarkers of Parkinson's disease. Study was carried out at 8 academic sites in the United States from 2012 to 2015. The study aims to complement the PPMI. These are the links to these studies. Once you got access to the Nearshare data access portal, you logged in, and you'll be able to see here the BioFind and PPMI navigation tabs. When you got access to Loni, you can load the raw data from Nearshare, actually from Loni via Nearshare. You also be able to download curated for Transmart data for both studies in CSV and text format. From here, you have an access to Transmart as well. You can use questions for help and click that page somewhere in the Nearshare. Now we're going to proceed to demonstration. We will do the demonstration on the Nearshare Transmart. And the goals of the demonstration is to explore the browse page, cohort selection, basic statistics, grid view and export of data, advanced workflows, as well as SmartR and Genome Browser. We're going to use PPMI and BioFind studies to repeat and visualize some published results and test hypotheses. For Transmart better performance, you should always use Chrome or Mozilla browsers. So now I'm going to change to Transmart. So once you access Transmart, it opens on its landing page browse. I should note that browse is not always available on all the instances by default. And that's why it will not appear. If you don't have browse on your instance, you will land at analyze field. So browse tab contains active filters and program explorer on the left side. On the right, it's a welcoming page which will show you the content of the program explorer of the programs on the open explorer on the program explorer, and Transmart menu tabs are on the top. So they contain browse, analyze, sample explorer, gene signature list, GWAS, upload data, and utilities. Program explorer is used to browse programs in a tree structure. The programs contain groups of related studies. If we click on the programs, we see that in Nearshare, it's BioFind and PPMI studies. Here, so clicking on any of this, we see content of the folders available in browse for these studies. And if we click on the study itself, we'll see the study metadata, brief description, associated tags with the study, and also a link to the study will be here. At the bottom, you see the field for the study documents. You can click it here or from here. Let's do that way. And you will see the folder with all the available study associated items, such as documents here. You can always export them to your computer one by one or export all. Browse is also used as a storage place on the Transmart server, where you can store files that you uploaded, that are uploaded in Transmart or not uploaded in Transmart. For example, sometimes it's a big genomic data that cannot be used in Transmart analysis, but the users want to have it in Transmart and download it from Transmart. So they can store all the data in the browser. So now a brief description of other main Transmart tools and functions. Analyze is used to view study data for subjects that you select based on criteria that you specify. You use it to compare data generated for subjects in two different cohorts based on criteria and points of comparison that you specify. Sample Explorer is used to search for data sets of tested tissue and blood samples within categories such as tissue type, pathology, and test type. Gene signature lists used to view definitions of existing gene signatures and add new gene signature lists that you're going to use in your Transmart analysis. Utilities contain submenus providing supplementary information or actions. So now we proceed to analyze. And we'll spend some time doing some analysis in this important analysis tab of Transmart. So you see on the left side is a navigation tree to select studies and variables of interest. So you can browse studies in this field. You know why it's opening all of it right away, because I was playing with it today. You can definitely browse every folder which we call node in Transmart to see what is the content of the study and what kind of data is available. This is a conventional for Transmart format, organizing data in a study tree by major categories, and in BioFind and PPMI, they are pretty similar. They contain assessments, which are clinical assessments, biomarker data, enrollment, medical history, patient status, subjects, and imaging in PPMI. Subjects are usually having demographics, which typically consists of numeric age, categorical data defined in Transmart with green, sex, race, and ethnicity. Subject characteristics may contain information on family history and socioeconomics, additional information on subjects' parameters such as handedness and primary diagnosis. Enrollment will have the data on enrollment and status of participation, which could be withdrawal, the reason of withdrawal, if patient died or something like that. Clinical assessments contain information on all clinical assessments in Parkinson's disease. We usually, if data available, divide them by subcategories for motor and non-motor assessments. PPMI has a long list of the different assessments here, including MDS, UPDRS, Schwab England activities on daily living, and others. In non-motor assessments, there are a lot of different assessments, few of which we're going to use today to show the functionality of Transmart. This also is used to define cohort by dragging concept from the nodes of the tree into subset boxes. So the right panel of analyze contains the subset definition boxes, safe and clear panels. Definition of subsets are very important for success of the analysis, and we'll spend a few minutes going through how to properly create subsets and how to save them for further use. So firstly, you can always drag the whole node into the subset one. Depending on what type of analysis you will go, it may be useful, and it also is useful for exporting data on your computer from Transmart, which we're going to look a little bit later. So cohorts could be selected based on categorical and both on categorical, numeric, and high dimensional expression data. Let's see how it works. So let's say we want to discover about healthy control. H is a numeric data. When you drag it in, it allows you to set a value. If we want to use binumeric value, it allows us to choose the interval or cut off of the data. And in this case, show diagram is very useful because it may help you to define what you want to choose as a cut off. I would choose here, for example, the interval of where the more data is. So it will be between 60 and 70. Remember, it's just an example. I don't pretend it's useful for analysis. And we can add here, to see how it works, the high dimensional gene expression data, which is available in BioFind, not in PPMI. And also it gives us we have to choose the gene symbol. And we can choose SNCA, which is a synuclein, important marker for Parkinson's disease. And here we can also use the cutoff of the data. So using include, you can include some more of, if you drag some node, and you want to cut off something of that node, let's say, we want to include race. It's from different study. What is it? If we drag race here, and we want to exclude. No, we cannot drag race here as a whole. But anyways, if we drag something together and then we're excluding, let's say, Asian from the list, then it will work for us. So once you created subset or subsets, and Transmart allows to compare two subsets, if the subset is complicated or you're going to use it many times, you can always save it. You click Save Comparison, give it a name. You can share it with public or save it for yourself that nobody will see it. And it will be saved in a workspace. So in the workspace, you see I created several cohorts that we're going to use today. You can always share them by emailing. You can always delete something you don't need. And in this case, I don't want to use this one. So I will go back and delete it. And for now, I will choose the previously created PPMI Parkinson's disease and healthy control subsets that we're going to discover further. So now we're going to summary statistics. Summary statistics is basic statistics analysis, which is widely used in clinical research. And so let's explore it, how to use it, this analysis in Transmart with available data, and also use it to repeat some published data. By default, summary statistics will always give the statistics on age, sex, and race. The numeric data is represented by boxes with mean, median, standard deviation, and number of observations data. It gives the numeric data diagrams as well. Plots are histograms and box plots. For categorical data, it represents it as a diagrams as well as gives the percentage distribution of the categorical data. So you all can always drag and drop into summary statistics categories from the study trees to calculate or compare the data. So now I want to proceed to using summary statistics to repeat some published data. And so here is the publication from 2015. The authors of this publication are actually the authors of part of the PPMI study affiliated with Michael J. Fox Foundation. And they used PPMI cohort with 423 PD subjects and 196 healthy controls. And they did comparison within these two groups at baseline, using wide range of motor and non-motor scales, including MDS-UPDRS and Epworth Sleepiness Scale. They defined excessive daytime sleepiness with cutoff 10, which means patients who had scores, ESS scores below 10 are considered defined as unsleepy and sleepy having scores of 10 or higher. Comparing PD subjects with healthy controls did not show difference in ESS scores between these two groups. 15.6% PD subjects and 12% of healthy controls had ESS scores of at least 10 or higher. Another comparison was done within a PD subjects group, where sleepiness positive and sleepiness negative patients were compared, and the difference was found in MDS-UPDRS part 1 and part 2 scores, but not part 3, as well as sleepiness was associated with a marginal reduction of A-beta, but not alpha-synuclein spinal fluid levels in subjects with Parkinson's disease. So the data in the paper is represented as a table. So you see here PD subjects, healthy controls, the values that were compared, and PD subjects ESS sleepy versus ESS minus non-sleepy. So now we're going to continue with our Transmart and repeat this data. So first we'll compare, as we have already cohorts of PD and healthy controls here, we're going to compare their ESS scores. So we're going to non-motor assessments, Epworth Sleepiness Scale, and summary score at baseline. We drag it here and drop. And here you are, we have analysis of baseline, and we see they're not significant, p-value is high. So repeating the data from the paper. Now, if we drag categorical baseline sleepy, non-sleepy, We will see the percent distribution and compare it with published paper. We have 65 patients or 15.4% of sleepy versus 12% non-sleepy patients in Parkinson's disease group and healthy controls. Now we can change the subset one to using, subset two for Parkinson's disease and compare sleepy versus non-sleepy patients by using advanced workflow. So now from basic statistic, we'll move to advanced workflow. Right. Okay, we're going to patient status, and in PPMI, we usually use enrollment category as a study group. So we drag Parkinson's disease into subset two. Go to summary statistics again to see what is in there. Oh. We want to also compare the ESS scores in Parkinson's disease, sleepy versus non-sleepy. So this will be the last analysis of basic statistics for today. So put it here. Just wanted to show you the the results with a significant difference. Okay, where you are. Oh, sorry. This shows you how important to create subsets properly. So I didn't create them properly. That's why I don't have result what I wanted to show you. So here we actually have to have the PPMI PD subject sleepy versus non-sleepy. So I choose this one group. Here we are. Now we have subset one of Parkinson's sleepy versus subset two Parkinson's not sleepy. And going back to our basic statistics. Now we can do that. Nope. Oh, sorry. We have to compare summary scores. Right. Summary score. Okay, here we are. The p-value is very low, and the difference is significant between sleepy and non-sleepy Parkinson's disease patients. So once you ran some basic statistics analysis here, you can always save them in PDF format using the print tab and choose save in PDF or BalZip printer if you have this program. Now let's navigate to grid view and explore this useful feature for Transmart and explore the export functionality of Transmart as well. So grid view follows the summary statistics and creates a table with the data by categories, like in a flat file. So if you have the whole study note in subset one, grid view as well as summary statistics by default will have only sex, age, and race categories, of course, including patient IDs here. Whatever you dragged in summary statistics, you will have here, and which you see, we have sleepy versus non-sleepy Parkinson's disease. We have groups here. You can always use sort and filter to sort the data and scroll and browse through what you have here. My Transmart is a little bit slow right now. Okay, so it sorted it. This is a very useful feature. You can always save this table of desired categories and data into your Excel, on your computer by clicking Export to Excel button. As soon as you click, it starts to download onto your computer the flat file with only the data you selected here. So while selecting, you can always remove some categories that you don't want to have in the list by going to columns and removing something that you feel like you don't need. We have maybe... For example, I don't need these ones. So you just unclick. I don't know why it doesn't work that well right now. Slow. But you always manipulate with this list to save for yourself. When you saved it, it will look like a very nice flat file, which I will show you right now. I saved it before. Like that. So you have all the data chosen from the list in the file. Oops. So another way to save the data onto your computer from Transmart is to use Data Export tab. So when you go to Export tab, you can download all the data available, and high dimensional will be always separated from clinical low dimensional data. You can download them all together or one by one. Let's say we want to, and because we have all separated here, by some as we use summary statistics and analysis, so we have two subsets separated. But if you want all the data together, you just have to let's clear panels, and you can use the whole study dragged into a subset one. Then you go to Data Export, and you'll see, let it load. Yeah, you see the whole cohort here and two types of data. So if you want to load clinical data, click Export. It starts running, and you can always run it in background and proceed to analysis further while it's uploading. To check if it's uploaded, you go to Export Jobs, and you see it's gathering data right now, but once it will complete, it will show completed, you can click on this, navigate to this name, and it will be downloaded onto your computer as a zip folder. Will look like a big flat file, which I saved to show you today. So it will look like that. NA means these data were not available. It contains all 1,673 patients from PPMI and total 15,552 column names with all available in the folders data. So as we learned how to save the data, we can explore the advanced workflow and smart R analysis. So advanced workflow contains a number of analyses that you can use based on the data that is available in the data set. So you see it's a long list of different analyses, while smart R has a shorter list, and some of these data analyses are the same as in advanced workflow, but the difference is that they are dynamic data, which you can visualize, and it has interaction. It's just different format of data, and sometimes it's very convenient to use smart R, and we start with smart R. So I wanted to continue with the comparison from the paper that I was showing you before, and compare the, we'll do the smart RBox plot workflow using, comparing the sleepy and non-sleepy patients for A-beta in CSF. So again, I'm going to workspace and choose my groups with PD sleepy and non-sleepy. These ones. We go to Smart R. Use box plot workflow and drag and drop here the data from biomarkers at baseline. So A beta at baseline goes to numeric values. We click fetch data. Once it completed the task, we can run analysis and choose raw values, logs, whatever we like to create plot. So now the plot is created. We see the p-value is shows the significant difference. And this is the box plots that if you navigate to any field of this box plot, it shows you the values of the data, standard deviations, and all. So you can always save this data using these navigation tools in the upper right corner. So I wanted to show you box plot in advanced workflow, but probably I will skip it for now. We better go to different type of analysis and use another publication, which shows that APOE genotype was associated with lower levels of A-beta in patients with Parkinson's disease and in healthy controls as well. This is paper of 2016. So I wanted to reproduce this data in using box plot with ANOVA in advanced workflow. So for this, we need only one subset, and we use Parkinson's disease patients to compare, that you see the difference of box plots in smart R and advanced workflow. We go to genetic data, APOE genotype, and for independent values, we use E3 and E4 groups to compare, and go in biomarker analysis for A-beta again at baseline. Run the analysis. And we see there is a significant difference between apoid genotypes in Parkinson's disease patients. Another advanced workflow analysis that we will discover for this type of data is a line graph. It allows to compare the longitudinal data. And for the same Parkinson's disease subset 1, we'll compare the, again, A-beta levels at baseline, putting them in time measurement concepts at month 6 and month 12, creating groups of different genotype to see if there was change happened within a year in the level of A-beta. And we see that the level of A-beta still stays significantly different in these two Parkinson's disease genotype groups. The authors of this paper also found the correlation between levels of CSF alpha-synuclein and A-beta in PD patients and healthy controls. And we can also go to correlation analysis, which will look differently in advanced workflow and SmartR. That's why I want to compare these two analyses, that you see the difference. So we leave the PD subset 1 and just drag and drop numeric values from baseline A beta levels and baseline alpha synuclein levels. You can always use correlation type here. We'll leave as is for quick comparison. Okay, so we're getting the coefficient of 0.38, which is exactly the same as the authors of the paper published for the group of Parkinson's disease patients right here. So this is how the correlation looks in advanced workflow. But in SmartR, it will look brighter. And like in the paper, it will have a plot with correlation line. So for that, again, we drag and drop numeric values here, fetch the data. And run analysis. Create plot. And this is how the results look here. And as I said, it's interactive. You can browse around. The coefficient is fairly the same. So now I think we're going to skip your other analysis of advanced workflow because I wanted to show you the genome browser. Let's go to genome browser. Yes, PPMI has genomic data for this type of analysis. I'll show you how Genome Browser can be used for visualizing data, genomic data from VCF files in Transmart. It's a very convenient feature and much more convenient than just to trying to see anything in VCF file. So When you go to Genome Browser, the first thing is to reset it every time when you change something. So you reset the browser. Then you have to identify the region of interest. And there are two ways how to do it. You can identify the region itself or type the gene name of region of which you want to look at the mutation status. Before, we may want to also choose two subsets to be able to compare the genetic data between these subsets and again, going into workspace, we'll choose Parkinson's disease and healthy controls. Come back to Genome Browser. Let's reset again in case. And I would type in here LARC2. Oh, okay. Let's type PARC7 then. So once we typed in and defined the region of interest, we'll drag and drop genetic data into the Genome Browser field. So in PPMI, exome sequencing data for 22 chromosomes and chromosome X and Y is available, as well as gene sequencing for indel and SNP data. So I'll use SNP data, drag and drop it here into the field. Click OK, okay. And we'll see a number of parameters available show up. And the gene variants contain location, name of SNP, shows the type of mutations. And these are two subsets data for subset 1 and subset 2, which we can look through. Let's look in some variants. For example, this one. So we see this is a Parkinson's subset. It contains the mutated nucleotide G to A. And if we look into this one of healthy control, I guess it's a healthy control. Oh, no, it's the same one. It's subset 1. We have to look at the same in subset 2, sorry. Yeah, variants for subset 2, healthy control, has G to A. And so we can look into all and see what it has here. So, I wanted to show you that. And also, of course, advanced workflow contains the analysis such as heat map, marker selection for high dimensional gene expression data, or in BioFind, also we have the data for metabolomics and proteomics that are high dimensional, and you can always build heat maps. If we have time, we have some few minutes left, so we can run analysis in BioFind. And to start with, I will choose marker selection because BioFind is a study to define biomarkers for Parkinson's disease and its progression. So we have to create two subgroups here, subsets here, and we'll choose PD and healthy controls to compare. go to gene expression data, drag and drop expression data here, and for faster performance, we'll can reduce the number of genes that will show up on the screen to 25 and just hit run. So while the analysis is running, I'll show you, I'll show you the results of this analysis in case it will be running a little bit longer than expected. Sometimes these high dimensional analyses are a little bit slow in Transmart. So this is how the result of marker selection looks like. It gives you a heat map for two subsets, and visually you see the difference. And also at the bottom, it gives a table of top markers. So these are top markers that I selected for a gene signature list that you can fill with other markers that you want to look at and use in other analysis, and load this into the gene signature list and use in the other high dimensional data analysis. So we'll stop this analysis because it's still running and I don't want to spend time for that. So the other analysis, I created slides because there are too much information. So, but this is how the advanced workflows heat map will look like when comparing two groups. You can calculate the score on the fly, and the boxes in the heat map are the scores from minus 2.5 to 2.5, showing which overexpression or low expression of the data that you compare. Hierarchical clustering allows you to show the clustering within each of subsets for the genes. When you run heat map in Smart R, you are choosing the gene symbols from the gene signature list that you uploaded in Transmart, as I showed one before. You type it in to select a biomarker, and then using the high dimensional data, fetch the data. Then you pre-process the data, choosing the parameters for your analysis right here. And after you chose those parameters, you hit create a plot. And the heat map will be generated as this kind of interactive plot where you can click on any of the probes here for each subject. This is how the cluster heat map on the fly looks like in Smart R, and this is the same type of analysis as clustering in advanced workflow. SmartR also contains volcano plot workflow, which is basically similar to the marker selection in advanced workflow. Here you can change the intervals of the data, reducing the list of the selected markers. When you adjust these sliders, you can get such a short list of or table of top markers. And I highlighted here, this analysis chose the same markers as were chosen by marker selection in advanced workflow. And finally, because Transmart has the connection to R API, you can always run analysis not only in Transmart but outside Transmart using R. By connecting R to Transmart, you get the data of your interest and run it on your computer, and some users prefer to do that. And this is the convenience of Transmart as well. So thank you. I think this is all I wanted to show you today. And if you have any questions, I will be happy to answer.
Well, thank you, Elena. So to ask questions, you can raise your hand. You can type a question into the question window or type something into the chat window. And whichever one you prefer, and I will. Okay, John, I will unmute you. Okay, John, go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, thank you. This was impressive. I was wondering, if we wanted to talk to someone at Transmart, what would be the best way to reach your group?
You want to talk on Transmart from which point of view? Because I guess Transmart Foundation is the first place to talk to people about it. But if you need help,
we've been using ITV2 some, kind of getting familiar with it, and then you know, there seems to be, it's a community of support, and you know, sometimes some details are lacking. Sometimes it's helpful to talk to somebody to kind of get a feel for, you know, what the vision is longer term. You know, if we were to try to use Transmart, what would be the, you know, process to follow? Just more general questions and how well it's supported, you know, for future issues or what the process is. If there's an issue, who do you actually reach out to? Those kinds of things.
I mean, I'd be happy to talk to you. This is Rudy. So I work at the foundation. So you can contact me. Trying to think where the best place to get. I'll put my email in the chat window.
You can always me an email if you want some details, technical details that I can help you understand. So,
fantastic.
Yeah. Because Rancho Bioscience is curating data for Transmart, we're loading data in Transmart. We have IT support for that. People who know how to establish Transmart, how to what features needs to be there for Transmart, and our curators know how to prepare the data and how to curate it for Transmart. So we can definitely help you to figure out what you need.
Okay. And I saw that you had a data upload feature there. I'm not sure what that is exactly. I mean, I know for most of these things, I imagine if it's the star schema, like ITV2, it's not just a simple matter, but.
You mean the data upload?
There was something you mentioned earlier. I know it wasn't part of this discussion, but I mean, I can discuss that offline.
Probably I was talking about the browse. When I was talking about the browse, and I said that you can use browse to store the data in Transmart, which you use or don't use, right? So the browse page allows to store data in Transmart. You can download it into browse page.
Oh, no, there's an upload data in the menu over near utilities. Yeah, I just wasn't sure what that was in general. Well, it's right next to utilities. I see something that says upload data. I didn't know if that was just files, you know, and that was about it.
Okay, let's see what that is. Let's see. I never used this function myself, actually.
Oh, that's fine. If you didn't, that's fine. Don't worry about it.
Too.
Not a problem.
Right.
Yeah, but putting data is a whole, you know, a whole separate, you know, set of capabilities, but that also obviously lots of things you need to worry about in terms of the curation of the data and all this, you know, this. So something that, you know, we have, there are a number of vendors who are available. Rancho is one of them, who does a lot of curation for, you know, helps people get their data in the right shape and loaded into the system. And, you know, they're a partner to the foundation. They've been providing these training classes, for example, you know, just to, you know, to help people understand the system. But I'd be happy to talk to you more about it, John. So,
sure.
You know, I put my email there. We can chat offline as well.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else have any questions? Otherwise, I'll thank you, Elena, again for another excellent webinar. This recording will be posted, hopefully, you know, within another day or two. And stay tuned to see what the training program schedule is for next year. And thank you all
thank
for
you.
Attending.
Thank you. Bye.
Okay. Bye-bye.